Hi, and welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina, and in this video, we're going to talk specifically about methods for suspending leg harness historically between the mid-14th century and early 15th century. I'm being very specific to that time period because it's a gray area in history as to how this was actually accomplished. There are two methods that seem to be very likely, or at least very possible for this interval in time, and we'll discuss each of them. The first is some sort of arming girdle or a waist suspension method, and the second method is to point the legs directly to an arming doublet. So we're going to talk about the arming girdle idea first. Okay, so the arming girdle idea comes from earlier sources where in the 13th century, circa 1250, in a publication called The King's Mirror, we hear that it states that male chausses are to be girded on with a double strap. Now, it doesn't get any more specific than that. It just tells us, it gives us that information. So we know that there's some sort of strap involved in hanging male chausses from the hips. We start to get clues from other 13th century sources, though. There are two 13th century German poems that talk about a very similar thing, and it talks about male iron hose being suspended from an object called a lendenier. The lendenier, the word, gives us a little bit more insight into what this thing actually was. The German word lenden translates to loin, which is defined as the part of the body above the hips but below the ribs, so basically through the soft part of the waist. So we now know that, at least in the 13th century, the lendenier was a means of suspending male chausses, some sort of strap girded on through the waist, through the loin area. But what was it made out of? It doesn't tell us. Could have been leather, could have been textile. We don't know for sure because it doesn't give us any more detail. Then in the mid-14th century, we start to get some more clues and some more specifics. But now we're a century removed from the original introduction of the term. But the term lendenier has survived and it's carried on. In the Limburger Chronicle in the mid-14th century, it states that the lendenier is to be laced tightly in the back, padded hard, a finger thick. So that suggests that it was some sort of padded garment. So likely a textile laced in the back, padded, to be made stiff. Now, circa 1370 document from Bruges, the city of Bruges, which was a trade hub in the Middle Ages, again uses the term lendenier, except this time in the it's written in both Dutch and French, and in the French translation, when it discusses that garment, it specifically says that it's made by a pourpointier, which is the craftsman responsible for constructing pourpoints. Now, by modern scholarship, a pourpoint is derives from the Latin prepunctus or perpunctus, meaning pierced or to pierce. So modern thinking is that the word pourpoint refers to any garment that is quilted. It doesn't necessarily mean any specific type of garment, but that the garment itself is quilted. So now we know that, based on that document, combined with the other evidence, at least in the mid-14th century, the lendenier is something that is likely a textile that's padded and quilted. Again, it doesn't give us any more specifics on that other than some likely materials that it was made out of. But then, to confuse the issue, around the turn of the 15th century, the term lendenier pops up again in the town of Göttingen, where we hear of a civil dispute being settled between pouch makers and shoemakers, and these are leather crafters, and it talks about who can and cannot produce lendenier and sell them. So were they made out of leather at this time? Were they made out of textiles in different places? Is this a regional difference? Were they both in production simultaneously? We don't know for sure. All we know is that in the 13th century, Londoner were used specifically for the suspension of male chausses, and the term survives through the 14th century. So it is a possibility that that is what they were still being used for, and we get some clues here and there as to how they were constructed, but nothing truly definitive. All right, so because we don't know exactly what they were made out of, I've experimented with both methods. So this was the first Londoner that I made, and it is made out of leather, and you can see it has kind of a U shape to it, and that's important because the top edge is shorter than the bottom edge, so when it is strapped closed, and it's going to be difficult to tell, but it actually forms a cone and not a rectangle. And what that does is it allows the upper edge to sit at the waist, and it's smaller than your hips, so it can't possibly slide down and over your hips, causing your mail or your plate harness to fall off. The way that I designed it was the top edge is reinforced with an additional piece of leather, as are the side edges, to prevent too much stretch, because you don't want it to stretch and then slide down over time. And it simply straps in the back with two strap and buckles. On the front, you can see where each of these corresponds to an arming point where I could attach leg harness. Now, based on the 14th century evidence, this is a new garment that I'm experimenting with. This is the padded and quilted version of the Londoner. So you can see again, it's kind of a gentle U shape. And again, that's very important because that's what that shape is what allows it to sit on the hips, and it's impossible for it to slide down because it can't. The top edge, when it's laced, is smaller in circumference than my hips, and it flares out over the hips so that it can't slide over. You can see here, this is the outside. It is a heavy linen, and then eyelets are sewn through the padding and allow the arming points to be worn, and then it is quilted over several layers of padding. This is the inside, a medium weight linen here, and then on the ends it is designed to be spiral laced closed. Okay, then by the mid-15th century, we start to see evidence for pointing legs to your doublet. In this image, you can see an image of King Syphax. He's been captured as a prisoner during a battle, and he's still wearing his martial garments, likely, and you can see here that there are arming points on the arms of the doublet. That would correspond to his arm harness, and then there are additional points around the peplum of the skirt on the doublet that would allow him to point his leg harness. This is another 15th century image that shows men in various stages of wearing armor. And you can see on the men who are not yet wearing their upper leg harness that they have points on the peplum of their skirts as well from the doublet. That could correspond to the wearing of leg harness. I know there's also a very popular garment on the market that's basically a vest that's used to accomplish the same thing. Speaking strictly from historical evidence, there's no direct documentational evidence or any artistic evidence that a vest-like garment was worn to suspend leg armor. And most of the images of that vest-type garment are late 15th century image used to suspend civil hosen. So I personally wouldn't use it and say that it's a historical method. Does it work? Yes, and it's a much better alternative to things like a leather seatbelt or something like that. But if you are trying to do things strictly by what you have evidence for historically for the use of leg armor, then my first choice would be the Londoner for the late 14th century, and then transitioning into suspension from a doublet. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to demonstrate both of these methods. First, I'm going to demonstrate the Lendinier method of leg suspension with my leg harness, and then I will show you how it is done with the doublet.
Okay, so right now I'm wearing the full base layer that you saw in the arming garments video with the addition of the Lendinier. You can see here's where the arming points will fall. They're right where my where the femur inserts into the hip socket to allow for maximum mobility when the leg armors point to it. The general shape, that cone shape, that flared shape, is what prevents it from being able to ride down when there's weight hanging from it, so that it's suspended here on the hips and waist and can't fall off. So now what I'm gonna do is put on the leg armor so that you can see how it actually functions with this. All right, so I've already got one full leg completely done and pointed to the Lendinier. You can see how the arming points go through here and attach. Now I'm going to add the other cuisse so you can see the process.
Get all the straps out of the way. I'm gonna line up the pin with the hole on the demi-greave. Now the strap on the back of the demi-greave will pass through the staple on the greave and strap tight. Back of the knee. Leave that one relatively loose.
Now you can see the top of the cuisse is still not attached. I'm gonna go ahead and point it. And you'll see what happens is it's going to lift the whole leg harness into place. Now I can tie that off. And do the same with the other side. Check the way it feels. If I need to adjust anything, make sure that the Lendinier has settled into place and I still retain full mobility of the legs.
And with the Lendinier on, I can still sit comfortably. It doesn't prevent any of that mobility.
Stand up, squat all the way down, lift my legs, kneel. None of that is inhibited. And if I jump up and down, the Lendinier doesn't slide down. Now we're going to take a look at the doublet method. Okay, so now I've got the doublet on. I've already got one leg pointed, and I will show you how to point the other leg. So I have the points going through lacing holes exactly like on the Lendinier. The points come out the inside, and again, I'm gonna do the same thing that I did with the Lendinier. Pull up tight, lift the leg harness into place, and tie it off. Okay, so comparatively, both garments, the doublet versus the Lendinier, function identically if they are made correctly. So the important part is that the doublet not transfer any weight to your shoulders. And that's why it has to be tailored the way it is, so that it's girdling through the hips and keeps that weight here on the waist. If you think about it, the doublet is almost a lendenier from here down that happens to be attached to the rest of a doublet, if that makes sense. So all the business for holding up my legs is right through here, not here. And remember, we talked about the importance of the grand assiette sleeve in the arming garments video. And now you can see why it's important. I have full range of motion of the shoulder joint without affecting the hem of the garment, which would in turn either restrict my motion. If every time I did this, I tried to lift the leg harness, it might stop me from getting my shoulder any higher than this. Or I might be trying to pull the leg armor up every time I did that, and that would be very fatiguing. Keeping the weight off of the shoulders also helps the back, because the more weight you have on your shoulders, the more vertical compression of the spine over time. If you're not holding good posture, it's going to start to weigh on the small of your back. This method keeps all the weight here and prevents it from transferring that weight to the shoulders. Which one is more historically valid? For the late 14th century, like we said, it's a gray area. Right now, with the evidence that we have, my leaning is that the lendenier is probably more appropriate to the late 14th century, and the doublet method maybe a little bit later than the 14th century. But there was likely overlap. It's possible that the lendenier never went away. We just don't know. So I'm going to experiment with both. Right now I've used the doublet a lot, and I'm going to start using the lendenier a little bit more and see if I get the same performance out of it and how it holds up wearing harness for long periods of time. So that's everything I wanted to talk to about the suspension of leg harness. So now you can actually see how it works and how it keeps that weight of the leg harness off of the sabaton. All the weight is suspended here so that the leg harness doesn't sit on the top of my foot. And like always, if anybody has any questions about what I'm wearing, how it functions, why I'm doing something the way I'm doing it, please leave those questions in the comment section below. I'll do my best to answer them. And if you like the video, please like it, subscribe. And in the next video, we will be back with mail.
Back under on this side. There's a staple at the top.
I'll continue that all the way up, and I'm not going to bore you with making it.
Plate, there's a strap that comes off the demi-greave plate that passes
through the staple. All right, well, I've got the doublet completely laced up now. And this is probably the most important piece of the whole greave and the cuisse.